Proper functioning of the body's many systems requires that a constant internal environment be maintained. This state is called homeostasis. The body achieves homeostasis through two main control systems. First is the nervous system, and second is the endocrine system. The endocrine system consists of glands and cells that secrete chemicals called hormones into the blood. These hormones then travel through the blood towards various cell targets, where they maintain homeostasis. Whether it's regulating metabolism, proper growth and development, ion levels, water balance, blood pressure, reproduction, or immunity, the endocrine system wears many hats within the body to ensure homeostasis. As you can imagine, proper functioning of the endocrine system is therefore integral to maintaining health. A challenge to proper endocrine function, however, are endocrine disruptors, which are chemicals that interfere with the proper functioning of the endocrine system. Given that the endocrine system has such a widespread role in maintaining homeostasis, it is not surprising that endocrine disruption is also associated with a myriad of health outcomes. For instance, dioxins are disruptors which can be produced from volcanoes, but nowadays are mostly byproducts of human processes, such as incineration of plastics and paper production. These molecules are fat-soluble, meaning that they can accumulate in the body's fat tissues. They can also persist in the body for up to 8 years. Studies have related heavily exposed subgroups to an increase in cancers, nervous system degeneration, immune damage, thyroid disease, and reproductive and sexual developmental disorders. However, not all endocrine disruptors are so clear-cut in their definition. For instance, phytoestrogens are another class of endocrine active compounds which have been associated with varying effects on human health. However, many studies of these compounds are characterized by very small sample sizes, which are known to amplify the effects of random variation, as well as possible conflicts of interest stemming from funding by manufacturers of soy and related supplements. But first, let's discuss what a phytoestrogen is. Phytoestrogens are naturally occurring plant compounds whose molecular structure resembles that of vertebrate steroid estrogens. Isoflavones are considered to be among the most estrogenic phytoestrogens, helping mostly to develop and maintain female sex characteristics. Owing to their richness in these compounds, soybeans and soy foods also became a subject of study. Soy contains three main types of isoflavones: genistein, daidzine, and glycine. Since they were first researched in the 1990s, isoflavones have almost always been associated with controversy. In fact, isoflavones first came to attention as a result of breeding problems experienced by Australian sheep, which had been grazing in the fields of isoflavone-rich clover. This led researchers to first question whether isoflavones could be culpable in impaired fertility among humans. In humans, isoflavones are processed into several compounds, many of which are estrogenic. Chief among these is EQUAL, which is even more estrogenic than its isoflavone precursor. The reason for isoflavones' endocrine activity stems from the fact that both isoflavones and estrogen use the same molecular pathways. When hormones interact with target cells, they do so through receptors, just like how you need a key to get through a locked door. Sometimes, these receptors may be on the surface of the cell, or sometimes they may occur within the cell, like nuclear receptors which bind the cell's DNA. Estrogenic compounds like estrogen itself bind to estrogen receptors which are present in several cell types, including the brain, bones, lungs, skin, testes, uterus, and kidneys. This changes the types of signals occurring within the cell and which proteins the cells make. Phytoestrogens, like estrogens, can also bind to these receptors, although not as strongly. At lower concentrations, they act in a similar way to normal estrogens, but at a high concentration, their effect is reversed as the compounds antagonize the activity of the estrogen receptors. Since phytoestrogens may be consumed in large amounts, it is not atypical to have phytoestrogen levels many times greater than the body's own estrogens, making up for the difference in binding strength. In the 1990s, the isoflavone controversy began as genistein was shown to stimulate the growth of mammary tumors in mice. This was supported by two other studies conducted a few years after. While downsides to their use have been documented, isoflavones aren't all bad. In fact, nowadays we recognize several benefits in humans. For example, isoflavones protect against the effects of chemotherapy, especially in breast and prostate cancers. They have also demonstrated a reduction in some symptoms of menopause and have been related to lower incidences of heart disease. Isoflavones, especially genistein, have been related to improved bone formation, potentially reducing the bone loss associated with osteoporosis. So, which is it? Do they cause or prevent illness? Well, as you can tell, the research is divided and largely ambiguous. Currently, many toxicology and food safety commissions around the world are evaluating the safety of isoflavones in young children. Given the increasing interest in plant-based diets and the prevalence of soy infant formula, it is important that isoflavones and their health effects be well studied. So, now for our original question. Are isoflavones, the phytoestrogens, truly endocrine disruptors? Well, that's a question of how we define them. The World Health Organization defines endocrine disruptors as substances that alter the function of the endocrine system and consequently cause adverse effects in the intact organism, its progeny, or populations of the organism. Adverse effects can include changes in appearance, physiology, growth, development, or lifespan. While there is recognition that isoflavones act on the endocrine system, making them endocrine-active substances, they are not necessarily endocrine disruptors, because adverse effects depend on the background physiological situation. While adverse effects have been documented in animals, there is a growing body of evidence suggesting that endocrine-disrupting effects observed in animals cannot be extrapolated to humans. But what does this mean to you? Should you be worried about consuming soy products? Well, many populations around the world consume soy products regularly and in large quantities. While they mostly consume traditional soy foods derived from whole soybeans, rather than soy ingredients or soy protein products, studies of Asian populations have demonstrated decreased incidences of breast cancer, prostate cancer, and menopause symptoms compared to Western populations. As well, soy infant formulas have been given to children over the decades and have been associated with normal growth and development in full-term infants. Nevertheless, this video should not be taken as medical advice, and any substance can cause harm if given at a high enough dose. To quote the Swiss physician Paracelsus, "What is there that is not poison? All things are poison, and nothing is without poison."